Kids want to come on.
Can I put the job?
الناوش دي دورة علمية تو. بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد. Sorry for coming late. We were finalizing the دورة علمية, the first intensive learning session. Inshallah, is going to happen, especially target for every one of you, of course. And we want to encourage everyone who's not involved into the learning or in this, I mean, we want the more people to be really student of knowledge. We want our youth, many of our youth, to be attending this. This is going to be, it helped many people to like an intro to come and join the Mahad, inshallah ta'ala. It's going to start, inshallah, after the Dawra Al-Ilmiyya is going to happen in Arabic with Sheikh Waleed, Sheikh Tariq, and Sheikh, I think, Muhammad Najib. That one is going to be starting the 1st August and ending the 10th. Ours in English is going to be, inshallah, we target to have a full week, an intensive learning full week, starting August the 12th and finishing, inshallah, a week after that, August the 19th, or make it 7 or 8 days. We're going to study it's going to be starting at 6 and it goes to 10 p.m. or Salat al-Isha, inshallah ta'ala. The 4 mutun that we decide, inshallah, to be sharing, the introduction of Risalat ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani in Aqidah. Then the matn of Usul al-Tafsir, the foundation or the roots of the explanation of the Quran, the Shaykh Abdul Rahman ibn al-Qasim. And then a matin in Mustalah al-Hadith, wahua al-matin known al-Bayquniyya. And then the provision, the 4th book of the Traveler to Allah, which is the book of Ibn al-Qayyim, al-Risala al-Tabukiyya. Fa-Injala is going to be a festival of knowledge. We let you know, we're going to be working on the flyers, but you already can spread the word, inshaAllah ta'ala. So that's what we were doing, inshaAllah. We continue بإذن الله تعالى شرح الزاد المستقنع, and we already finished, right, with صلاة الاستسقاء, right? We've been starting today كتاب الجنائز. الجنازة الجنازة جمع جنازة, الجنائز جمع جنازة. نعم, if you I'll put it back then. Just testing. بسم الله. It's good like this. Yeah, it's good. الحمد لله. قال كتاب الجنائز. كتاب الجنائز. The book of الجنائز. الجنائز is the plural of جنازة. The plural of جنازة. And it comes with fathul jimi janaza and with kasrul jimi jinaza. Wal janazatu with the ja, with the fath, is for the deceased person, the one who passed away. Janaza, lil mayyit. And al kasru al jinazatu is lima yuhmalu alayhi al mayyit, is what you carry the dead person on it, is al nash. So call it jinaza. And subhanAllah, al-fathatu is on the top of the letter and al-kasratu on the bottom. So it suits that al-janazatu is the dead person on top of the janaza, which is the what you carry the dead person on it. قال ثم يذكر المؤلف رحمه الله. And al-janaza is the preparation and the whole thing that concerned the one who passed away. And we start, of course, by a reminder that death is a fact, is a reality that everyone is going to go through, is a transition to the next life. قَالَ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ دَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. The تَذْكِيرُ, the fact to remember death, it's not something that makes someone sad, but it makes someone, for the believer, to get ready and to have his preparation and his awareness toward the end that is going to come with no doubt. So therefore, we have one of the scholar who called his book Sharh al-Sudur بِذِكْرَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْقُبُورِ, opening the chest in a way and expanding the chest with tranquility when you remember the dead and the graves. Because the remembrance of the death and the graves is a reality. So when someone knows about them, this is will help someone really to know that reality and to be prepared for that reality. Because the one who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no way to meet Allah except by going through death. And no one can run away from death. So Kitab al-Janaiz is from the book of the fiqh, that it will be introduced in al-Janaiz, even though there is the preparation how to the ghusl and everything, which nothing have to do with the prayer, but salatul janaza, the salat on the one who the person deceased, it has the salat. That's why the author rahimahullah ta'ala put this book or this chapter in the book of the salat. قال المؤلف, the first thing, قال تسن عيادة المريض وتذكيره التوبة التوبة والوصية تسن عيادة المريض. The first thing, like we're talking about the general way of someone who will, you know, going through death, which is the المريض, so to be sick, to be ill. قال تسن عيادة المريض. تسن عيادة المريض, it is from the sunnah to visit the sick. It is from the sunnah is to visit the sick. That's the meaning of تسن عيادة المريض. And alhamdulillah, in the exhaustiveness of the deen of Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger taught us all the way how to dignify the human being, the Muslim, in his life and in his death. Though this is part of the amana, of the trust that the believer they have between each other. And this is also part of the rights that the believer they have between each other. And to dignify a human being is to give him a proper funeral, a proper janazah, a proper burial. And this is Islam made it to be part of the worship. As we're going to see the ahkam related to that. It is an obligation on all of us. Is a collective obligation or it is an individual obligation. قال عيادة المريض. عيادة المريض, visiting the sick. And المريض, and we're talking about المرض, so we need to, there's the person who's sick and then the type of the sickness that he has. Because not any sickness that someone is from the sunnah to go visit the sick. So the scholar, they say, قال المرض من مرض مرضا يحبسه عن الخروج من الناس. So it's talking about the sickness that prevent the person, a disease who hold him from going out, going to his work, going to his business, going to the masjid, so people, they don't see him. But any type of a disease that will not hold a person from not coming out, Therefore, it's not from the sunnah. It's not like someone should not, I mean, we're not thinking about visiting the sick. So visiting the sick is a sick that he's been held by the sickness to be staying at home. Iyadatul Marid is from the rights of a Muslim on his brother Muslim and on the Muslim on her sister Muslim. Because the Prophet ﷺ in two hadith قَالَ حَقُّ الْمُسْلِمِ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِ خَمْسْ and another hadith قَالَ sit. The rights of a Muslim on his brother Muslim are five and are the six. Among them is to visit him when he's sick, to meet him, to greet him when he see him, and all those, you know, known from the huquq of the rights of a Muslim on a Muslim. Among them is to visit him. Among them also when he invites you, you answer the invitation. When he asks you to help, you go for his help, etc. So this is specific for the Muslim, specific for the Muslim. If the person is not Muslim, then it depends on the relation that the person he has with. But when he's a Muslim, to sunnu, as he said, is from the sunnah to go. So qala tusannu here, so it is sunnah for everyone from the Muslim. But here it requires some of the clarification, because if someone, his father is sick, is not sunnah anymore, it becomes the equation. That's why in general is sunnah. In general is sunnah. But for some relatives and some close people, it becomes wajib. Actually, it's wajib to take care of them more than to only visit them. And that's why some of the scholars, they put the visiting the sick from the collective obligation, the collective obligation. So they say wajib kifai. So a group need to visit one of the, you know, the sick. Because if no one will visit him, that's, subhanAllah, is like neglecting this brother or this sister. So if group will visit him, it will be enough for the rest of the community who didn't visit or those who know him. قال إنه واجب كفائي أن يجب على المسلمين أن يعودوا مرضاهم وهذا هو الصحيح. This is the strongest opinion, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the visiting of the sick of the Muslim is right on their brother, the right of a Muslim on a Muslim. Now, when it comes to the time and the length of someone to be, like how long or how long someone will be staying, this is doesn't have really a standard. We cannot, we know that someone when he goes, he should not stay a long time, so he will not burden the sick person when he visit him. But reality, there is no in the sunnah or in the sharia, you know, tahdeed, restriction, or clarification. I will not say clarification, but there is no quantification of the time of the visiting or when to visit. So this is comes back to the arf, to the standard or to the habit of the people and to the convenience of the person. So what is going to be put here as a priority is the convenience of the person, because sometimes you go visit someone who didn't see any person for some time, and he wants you to be next to him for some time. So that's, you know, extending the stay with this person because he feel comfortable being with the person who visited. Other people, they are sick, they are, you know, need to take some medication, they are, you know, need to rest. So someone, subhanAllah, depends on the convenience, depends on the situation, he need to be like considering based mainly the situation of the sick person, to not bother him, to not burden him, and if he required to be sitting with him and, you know, feel comfortable with him, feel like, you know, kind of closeness and feel like joyful to be with him, that's someone he will extend his stay. So there's no real standard here or quantification exactly on how someone is going to be when and or how long he will be staying. So this is depends on the habit and maybe on the convenience of the sick person. ثم قال in the matin قال تسن عيادة المريض وتذكيره التوبة والوصية. And then someone should remind him repentance and remind him to do the wasiyya. And here also comes back also subhanallah to the way that someone at the convenience, because the believer is always someone who spread mercy and kindness. And should not, for example, when he knows, for example, say, when you go to visit the sick, you have to remind him, you know, tawbah, and you remind him the wasiyyah. The wasiyyah, the will. Did he write his will? Did he did this? You know, did he do such a thing? So this is, it depends also. Why? Because sometimes when you enter, when in a harsh way, someone is saying, did you make your tawbah? Did you write your wasiyyah? It's like, you know, you're preparing him, telling him you're going to die now. And that's not the way how to talk to someone who's sick. You know, it's not the way to talk to someone who's sick. فَقَالَ وَتَذْكِيرُهُ التَّوْبَ وَالْوَصِيَّ أَيْ وَيُسَنُّ أَنْ يُذَكِّرَهُ التَّوْبَ وَالْوَصِيَّ. It is from the sunnah to remind him such a thing. قال, but the most important is to take the right time and the right way to do it, because some of the scholars, they say you should not remind him the wasiyyah if he's sick, you know, is like not that sickness who's really serious sickness. But the tawbah, as many of the scholars, as I will share with you here, قال قال أما التوبة فيذكره بها مطلقة. Because some of the scars depends, or they say depends on the sickness. But we say when it comes to the tawbah, it is first we remind ourselves of the repentance. Therefore, when someone is sick, that sickness might be for him, inshallah, as the Prophet ﷺ told us, the sickness will be like expiation to his sin, erasing to his sin. Therefore, if you remind him the tawbah, that you really help him to make out of that sickness a way for him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him. So the tawbah does not have a condition here, because mutlaqa, at the absolute. You remind me the tawbah, I remind you the tawbah, and if he's sick, someone is more likely, because he's more, you know, in a state of fragile, in a state of being, you know, close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So remind him the tawbah, yes, at, you know, doesn't have any restriction to remind him the tawbah, but in a nice way. قال أما التوبة فيذكره بها مطلقة ولو كان المرض غير مخوف لأن التوبة مطلوبة. التوبة مطلوبة في كل حال. Even the disease is not a serious disease that someone is like, he's concerned that this person is going to die. No, the tawbah is required to be, you know, reminded. قال والوصية. Some scholars, they're saying, والوصية لا يذكره بها إلا إذا كان المرض مخوفا. And the wasiyya, he will not remind him only if the disease or the sickness that he's going through, it's really, you know, concerning sickness that he might die with this sickness. Some of the scholars, they say, if you look at the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that it is upon every Muslim believer, he has something in his hand, or he has anything like loan, or has things that people that don't know about it, that he has to write his wasiyya, that his wasiyya need to be under his head when he sleeps and his pillow. قال ما حق ما حق امرئ مسلم له شيء يوصي فيه يبيت ليلة أو ليلتين إلا ووصيته مكتوبة عنده. I mean the right of an believer, that he, the one who has anything, you know, to deal with, anything that he has to write it as a will, you know, to remind people around it, you know, properties, things, or anything, even not in a financial way, that he has to write his wasiyyah. So based on that, you know, for the therefore they add to the tawbah that also the wasiyah need to be reminded to. But we'll say as depends, really depends, because the wasiyah, when he, that person, you can remind him in this condition wasiyah even if he's not sick. So if you do it on the time when he's sick, that it might really demoralize him, might scare him, depends on these people. Because people who have yaqeen and certainty in their heart and the strong belief, those, they don't need even a reminder. But when people are weak, you know, to say the wasiyah, that it's really, he feel like he's going to die, and maybe that sorrow that being caused by certain, you know, reminder, make him to increase his disease. So the tawbah, and then the wasiyah really depends on the situation of the person. The tawbah, and then if, but if still really the sickness is a sickness that someone he thinks or presume it might be the, you know, the sickness leading to the end of his life, someone need to remind him the wasiyah. So that's what he said, rahimahullah ta'ala. قَالَ تُسَنُّ عِيَادَةُ الْمَرِيضِ وَتَذْكِيرُهُ التَّوْبَةُ وَالْوَصِيَّةُ. And here he said something, you know, important as a reminder. And he said every time someone write wasiyah, he need to say this wasiyah annul and abrogate the one that I wrote before. Because if he dies and people they found like one he wrote, you know, some time ago, and it has different element that he didn't mention in the last wasiyah, then it's going to conflicting the awsiyah. They're not going to know what to do. So in the beginning, after the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending the blessing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he says someone قال وهذه الوصية ناسخة لما قبلها أو ما سبقها, and this wasiyah abrogate and annul any wasiyah I wrote before. And from the sunnah also, when someone visit a sick person, that he make for him ruqya. He make for him ruqya. The ruqya, especially if the sick person is expecting that, he's wishing that. And the best of the ruqya is Surah Al-Fatiha, you know, and make dua for him. ثم قال المصنف وَإِذَا نَزَلَ بِهِ وَإِذَا نَزَلَ بِهِ. نَزَلَ بِهِ is death. Is death. Sunnah, the sunnah, when death will come, like now is the person, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us in those conditions. قَالَ وَإِذَا نَزَلَ بِهِ, when it comes, sunnah, the sunnah, ta'ahudu balla halqihi bima'in aw sharabin. So someone here qal wa idha nazala bihi ay nazala bihi al malak. Here death comes, so the angel comes to take the life. Liqabdi ruhihi wal malak alladhi yaqbidu ar-ruh huwa malak al maut. Malak al maut. Malakul Maut, the angel of death, and he has also angels who help him in his task. And Malakul Maut, in the Sunnah, we don't know, nor in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mention his name. There's the name that is known, Azrael, is a name mentioned in the books of the people of the book, but is not proven into the Sunnah or in the text of our Sharia. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قال قل يتوفاكم ملك الموت الذي وكل بكم. Who the one who يتوفاكم take your soul is ملك الموت. ملك الموت. يتوفى is to take the soul. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned also in different ayat. قال الله يتوفى الأنفس. Allah is the one who take the soul. قال إذا حتى إذا جاءتهم رسولنا يتوفونهم till when our messenger came to take them. And all of them complete each other. Because the angel cannot take the soul without the permission of Allah. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says يتوفى is Allah by His will, permission, and the will that He gave to the angel of death to do it. And the angel of death, he has many of his helpers to fulfill this task, to fulfill. Because they will be helping him, as he is saying, قال, helping him to get the soul up to the throat, and then the angel of death will take it. فهنا قال سنة تعاهد بل حلقه بماء أو شراب. بماء أو شراب. At that moment, subhanAllah, they wet his mouth with water or give him to drink. Not a lot of water, because a lot of water someone will choke. But he like to wet his lips and his mouth so it will be easy for him to say the shahada. So he can speak. قالوا يسن أن يتعاهد الإنسان يسن أن يتعاهد الإنسان. So it's from the sunnah that people they get this way to do. قال بل حلق المحتضر بماء أو شراب. بماء أو شراب. To wet the throat. So to wet the throat is give him like you know drip or some sips of water. So just to wet his throat. And his lips. And of course, not a lot of water, because a lot of water can cause him, you know, hurt. And in this situation, it would, the objective is to have this wetness to help the muhtadar, the one who's in al-ihtidhar. Al-ihtidhar, he's in agony of death. قال من أجل أن يسهل عليه النطق بالشهادة. To make easy for him that he can pronounce the شهادة. And this is where the leniency and the kindness and the pity need to be, you know, the way to deal with this person who's dying. قال بماء أو شراب. بماء أو شراب. بماء أو شراب. ماء the water and شراب it might be any type of drinks, juice or things that will help in this fulfill this task. قال وتندية شفتيه بقطنة. التندية is also to wet. To take a cotton, dipped in water, and to wet his lips. وتندية شفتيه بقطنة. And then وتلقينه. وتلقينه. تلقينه because subhanAllah when they put the water everything comes to become hard. Yabs. He's drying out with this agony of death. So he helped him to have him the favorable condition to help him say easily the shahad. وتلقينه لا إله إلا الله مرة. تلقينه is like not to remind him. التلقين is like you teach him. The way how you teach someone Quran. تعليمه. He's like you say, say الحمد لله رب العالمين. So تلقين you say لا إله إلا الله. تلقين. It's like as you doing for the student to teach him for the first time the saying of La ilaha illallah or the saying of the Alhamd. Here, should he say with an order, command, say La ilaha illallah? Should we say to the one who is dying, قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, or we say only La ilaha illallah? In this condition, the author saying someone need to look at the condition of the one dying, the sick person. إن كان المريض قويا يتحمل, if the sick person, the one dying, is known by someone he is strong, and he can accept that, or if he is not a believer, if he is not a believer, you order him, قل لا إله إلا الله, say it, finish your life with لا إله إلا الله. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he ordered his uncle Abu Abi Talib, he ordered his uncle Abu Talib to say it. عند وفاته أن يقول قل قال قلها يا عماه قل لا إله إلا الله يا عم قل لا إله oh my uncle say لا إله إلا الله. But if someone he's weak, no, someone known by his piety and you know and his strength and strong belief, strong is not like in muscle, right? Strong in his deen. Tell him say la ilaha illallah, say, so you remind him in that. But if someone is sick, when you say say, you know, subhanallah, when someone is not very into the deen, when you say say, you someone he can doubt him. Is that, are you telling me say because I'm not Muslim or things like that? So subhanAllah, when you say mu'minun qawi or muslimun qawi, someone he's strong in his deen. So when you tell him say, you're not doubting him. If someone he's weak, I mean when we say weak, he's not a person who's really close to Allah, he's not a person of da'wah or student of knowledge or someone who's like lately come to the masjid. So that one you say La ilaha illallah, you remind him, say La ilaha illallah next to him closely, and you laqinuh La ilaha illallah. تلقينه لا إله إلا الله. And he didn't say محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He didn't say وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. Because this is what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told us. He said in the hadith لقنوا موتاكم لا إله إلا الله. حديث أخرجه مسلم عن أبي سعيد الخدري. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the other hadith أخرجه أبو داود والحاكم عن معاذ ابن جبل رضي الله تعالى عنه قال من كان آخر كلامه من الدنيا لا إله إلا الله دخل الجنة. Whoever whose last words in this life, in this worldly life, is لا إله إلا الله will be admitted to paradise. فكلمة التوحيد مفتاح الإسلام. كلمة التوحيد, the statement, the words of the oneness of Allah is the key of Islam. ولو جمع بين الشهادتين فحسن. If he will say them both, لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله, that's good. But if he say أشهد أن محمد رسول الله, is not enough for him if he doesn't say La ilaha illallah. Because the witness of the Prophet ﷺ, the seal of the Prophet ﷺ, is affirmation and confirmation of La ilaha illallah. Because tabi'a follow that. The Prophet calling us for La ilaha illallah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, the shahada of the Prophet ﷺ, he made it with La ilaha illallah, is like one. That's how we acknowledge the deity and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, the one who conveyed the message that there is no God except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who taught us, the one who all his message, all his life is to teach us and to convey for us La ilaha illallah. قال ولم يزد على ثلاث and he should not do it more than three times. Why also the situation no one will know it. It's a very difficult situation. It's a very difficult situation. When Amr ibn al-As, he used to say to his son, Abdullah ibn Amr, I wish someone tell me or tell us from those who are dying what they feel. When he was dying, his son, Abdullah ibn Amr, he told him, he used to say this, can you tell me what you feel now? So he didn't have the answer, but he's at this situation. He said, yeah, bunayy, in the meaning. He said, this agony of death, it will be lighter for someone to be stabbed with a thousand swords than to endure this agony of death. Said, this agony of death, it's like a bird being trapped in a pot boiling with oil and he could not fly. So the hukum that we're studying based on thinking of a person. So more than three times, you're going to burden this person. Confuse him, burden him. Because he's in a situation, he might not be able to listen or ready to listen. No, he's in a different dimension. وَلَمْ يَزِدْ عَلَىٰ ثَلَاثٍ وَعِلَّةُ ذَلِكَ عَدَمْ حَتَّى لَا يَضْجَرَ الْمَرِيضِ يَضْجَر, so he will not be like, you know, get like bewildered, or fed up in a city, or burden, we don't want such a thing. And also from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, the way of the Prophet ﷺ, when he speaks, he only speaks three times. From his sunnah, he will say things three times. So we limit at three times. Because the person, he might be in a situation that he's already in the other side of the world, of the life, first. Second, he might be saying it in his heart that we cannot even listen or say it. So we don't know. Third, the one who helped him to move his tongue is Allah. So you say it one or a hundred times, it might not help. Because the one who going to move his tongue, قَالَ يُثَبِّتُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. Allah give the firm speech for the believers in life and in the akhirah and the after. The scholar, they say, in his time of life, when he's dying, In the hereafter, at the question in the grave. And so on. So, thalathan, the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Because someone whose his heart is opposing La ilaha illallah, if you say it, if you put like a tape repeating 24 hours, it's not gonna happen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam قال عادة إذا تكلم تكلم ثلاثا وإذا سلم سلم ثلاثا وإذا استأذن استأذن ثلاثا. The Prophet, when he used to talk and repeat the words for لا تغضب لا تغضب لا تغضب, three times he will say. So he only speaks three times. When he greets and there's someone who's listening, he'll do it three times. When he's asking for permission, knocking on the door, he does three times. So we limit ourselves according to the to what is known from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قال إلا أن يتكلم بعده فيعيد تلقينه برفق. Unless the one who's in agony, the sick, the deceased person, he will speak after that. He will say, for example, I need water, I need thing, he will talk. After he talk, then it is permissible to do the talqin again, because he say words and we want that his last word to be the La ilaha illallah. So if he doesn't speak three times, and we'll stop there. If he'll speak back, then the talqin is permissible to redo it again. The next one, the next hukum. قال وتلقينه لا إله إلا الله مرة ولم يزد على ثلاث إلا أن يتكلم بعده فيعيد تلقينه برفق ويقرأ عنده ياسين ويقرأ عنده ياسين. And he read as his at his side Surah Yasin. Surah Yasin. لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اقرأوا على موتاكم ياسين. اقرأوا على موتاكم ياسين. Hadith, it has, you know, maqal wa mukhtalafun fih. There's differences of opinion in the authenticity of the hadith. Ad-Darqutni, he said, this is weak hadith. Wada'afa ibn al-Qattan إلى آخره والنووي في الأذكار. And whoever who has the hadith at the grade of the Hassan, he applying this hadith. Following the those who graded Hassan and in what the author is saying, let's see what the benefit of reciting Surah Yasin. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, if we explain the hadith, قال اقرأوا على موتاكم. موتاكم, those who are dying, not those who died. Because many people, they sit on the grave after the burial and people, they read Yasin. That's nothing you have to do from the sunnah. The Quran is for the living people to reflect on it and to help them, not on the dead people. The dead people, they don't listen. إِنَّكَ لَا تُسْمِعُ الْمَوْتَ. So, عَلَى مَوْتَاكُمْ أَيْ إِلَى مَا يَؤُولُ إِلَيْهِ. In the Arabic, you say, read Yasin on the those مَوْتَاكُمْ, on the dead ones, no, on the dying ones. Those who's going to die, that you are certain that you're going to die, that's the one that you're going to read. Not the sick person that he's like, he has normal sickness, you read on him, Surah Yasin. Say, they want to kill me. He's not going to appreciate it. طيب. بعض العلماء they mention some of the benefit of reading Surah Yasin. When he will hear in the end of the second page, قيل ادخل الجنة. It's been said to him, enter paradise. That's nice. He will hear it while he's in agony of death. قيل ادخل الجنة. قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون. والتشويق للجنة فيه تسهيل لخروج الروح. And when someone longing to the Jannah, it makes easy for the soul to leave the body. Because the soul will hold on every part of the cells inside and the vein to not get out. That's why the ungrateful, the disbeliever, the coming out of the soul, شاقة والعياذ بالله. It's like something rooted in the earth. It's going to take a long time, big effort to get it out. But when something is smooth and you take it out, it comes with you. So especially when something is ripe, you take it, you just touch it, it comes with you. That's the life of the believer or the soul of the believer. قال والتسويق وإذا ولهذا إذا بشر بالجنة سهل عليه make easy for him the agony and whoever who loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet him back. And this is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said when someone is dying. And in the ayat also قوله سبحانه وتعالى إن أصحاب الجنة اليوم في شغل فاكهون. The people of paradise today are busy in their entertainment and in enjoyment and happiness. So he's going to give him an image of what is going to come. And the surah, masha'Allah, ends with Qudratullah, the power of Allah, that he's going to bring back dead to life. يحيي العظام وهي رميم سبحان. So he gave him that certainty that he's dying on the right path, on the true belief. اقرأوا it required to be heard by the dying person. So it's jahran. And the tone and the how loud is the voice depends on the one who's dying. If at the end it needs to be with a louder voice to get him the voice to his being, subhanAllah. This qira'ah should not have nafath. You know, when taflu, when some people, they read al-Fatiha or the thing, they do this and they wipe on the places with this pain, like the ruqya. Surah Yasin, you don't do that because he's dying. Nothing is going to help him bring him back to life. But you help him to leave. Make easy for him his departure to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ويوجهه إلى القبلة and he direct the dead person to the Qibla. And to direct a dead person to the Qibla, there is no clear or obvious hadith or narration in this. ولكن يروى في أحاديث أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أشرف مجالسكم ما استقبلتم به القبلة. The best of your way when you're sitting in when you face the قبلة. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم also has been narrated that he said قال البيت الحرام قبلتكم أحياء وأمواتا. البيت الحرام the Kaaba is your Qibla, is your where to face alive and dead. So alive and dead and also dying into it. Both of these hadith are da'ifa. But we have another hadith who can strengthen this hadith narrated by Al-Hakim wal-Bayhaqi and Abi Qatada. أن البراء ابن معرور البراء ابن معرور one of the companion أوصى عند موته أن يستقبل به القبلة فبلغ ذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He had this recommendation, this will, when he died, when he's been dying, to be facing the Qibla. When the Prophet said, they mentioned that to the Prophet, قَالَ أَصَابَ الْفِطْرَةِ. He did the what the inner nature is someone أَصَابَ الْفِطْرَةِ. الْفِطْرَةُ is the Islam. He did really did well by fulfilling exactly what someone should have done. What the nature, the inner nature will be longing to do is to be facing the Qibla when dying. But going back in the action of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companion, there is no specification on such an action. And even when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the Hijri Aisha, fi Hijri Aisha, قال ولم يذكر أنها استقبلت به القبلة. And it wasn't mentioned that she turned him toward the Qibla. And this is in Sahih al-Bukhari. So it's not like an obligation to have such a thing, but it is good. And the ahadith, as mentioned, if there's goes to Hassan, then it's good to do it. But it's not an obligation. To face someone Qibla, is either laying on his right side to face him the Qibla, on his left side, or to put his to lay down facing the Qibla, so his legs will be to the Qibla and his head will be on the other side. So in the way when he sits, he will be facing the Qibla. So this is the sides, is either on both, one of each side. Laying on one of his side will be laying facing the Qibla, and that's how actually he will be put in the lahd, or in the way that we mentioned. فَإِذَا مَاتَ سَنَّ تَغْمِيضُهُ فَإِذَا مَاتَ. So when he dies, سُنَّ تَغْمِيضُهُ وَشُدَّ لَحْيَيْهِ وَتَلْيِينُ مَفَاصِلِهِ وَخَلْعِ ثِيَابِهِ وَسُتْرِهِ بِثَوْبٍ وَوَضْعِ حَدِيدَةٍ عَلَى بَطْنِهِ وَوَضْعِهِ عَلَى سَرِيرِ غَسْلِهِ مُتَوَجِّهًا مُنْحَدِرًا نَحْوَ رِجْلَيْهِ. Now, this all the procedure, that procedure are done at that time. And this is the way to be done, but there is no specification or details from the Sunnah to tell us to do such a thing. But the Taghmid, it is in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, to close his eyes. فَإِن مَاتَ, when he dies, from the Sunnah is to close his eyes. So this is the first thing, as soon as someone will pass away, this is the first thing to do. قال والإنسان إذا مات شخص بصره. شخص بصره, his eyes will be staring and not moving. شخص, because the eyes is the last where they see the soul going. So as in the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال يتبع الروح. So from the sunnah is to close his eyes. The evidence is hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when he entered and he find for Abu Salama. Abu Salama, he was dying. قال لما دخل على أبي سلمة ورأى بصره قد شخص. And he saw his eyes looking up, staring up. قال إن الروح إذا قبض أتبعه البصر. When the soul is taken, the what will follow the soul is the eyes. فسمعه من في البيت فضجوا. So the people outside, they heard him. When the Prophet said this hadith, they knew that Abu Salama passed away. So everyone will be like, you know, ضجوا, they get crying and طيب إن شاء الله we take the break for صلاة العصر. It's 5:42. The salat is as 5:45, and after the salat we'll meet you back here إن شاء الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد فقال الحديث الذي ذكر فيه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم التغميض the evidence and the proof and the hadith which is the hadith in which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned the fact to close the eyes And it was for Abi Salama. It was for Abi Salama. فإنه لما دخل على أبي سلمة ورأى بصره قد شخص قال إن الروح إذا قبض اتبعه البصر. When the soul is being taken, the sight and the eyes will follow the soul. فسمعه من في البيت فضجوا. So when they heard him, they knew that Abu Salama passed away. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تدعوا على أنفسكم إلا بخير فإن الملائكة يؤمنون على ما تقولون The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم then warned them to remind them do not ask or supplicate with anything that is wrong or that is harmful to you because the angels are present and they are making or like saying ameen to your dua. يُؤَمِّنُونَ عَلَى دُعَائِكُمْ They making dua for Allah by saying ameen for Allah to accept what they're saying. So people sometimes when in time of death they will be like screaming and saying things and this is our end, you know, this is our destruction. So that's calling such a thing like in the time of ignorance they say وَثُبُرَى This is, you know, they're saying things, harmful thing. So if they're saying things like that because of their sadness or the sorrow, that thing is like hurting them if it will really happen to them. So the Prophet ﷺ prohibit us and prohibit them to say such a thing because the angels are saying Ameen. So might someone make dua against his own self? And if it's going to be this dua accepted, it's going to hurt him. قَالَ لَا تَدُعَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ إلا بخير. Don't ask in this situation. Only good. Only good. فإن الملائكة يؤمنون على ما تقولون. And someone in a state of sorrow, he's in a state also of humility, and the du'a is most likely to be accepted. And then he said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, du'a for أبي سلمة. قال اللهم اغفر لأبي سلمة وارفع درجته في المهديين. وافسح له في قبره ونور له فيه واخلفه في عقبه في الغابرين هو الله forgive to Abi Salama and raise his ranks among the guided ones and وافسح له في قبره and widen or make wide open his grave ونوّل له فيه and make it to be filled with light واخلفه في عقبه في الغابرين and واخلفه succeed him in on whom he left behind him to be taken care of. And this da'awat was a tremendous dua for Abi Salama. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the one who take care of the offspring of Abi Salama, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam later on, he married Ummu Salama. And the time when someone closing the eyes is good to say the dua that we mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Abi Salama, which is again, Allahumma ighfir li fulan warfa' darajatahu fil mahdiyyin wafsah lahu fi qabrihi wanawwil lahu fihi wakhlufhu fi 'aqibihi wakhlufhu fi 'aqibihi. Allahumma ighfir li fulan, forgive to so and so, وارفع درجته في المهديين وافسح له في قبره ونور عليه فيه واخلفه في عقبه. ثم قال فإذا مات سن تغميضه وشد لحييه وشد لحييه. لحيين is this, the jaws. It's good to attach them with the rope or to attach from here. Why? Because the body is still warm. And when someone lost all control, so everything will open up. So you close his eyes and you hold or you attach his jaws. Because if they open, his mouth will be open. And then he get cold, it will not be possible to, it's going to be difficult to close it. And then after the body get cold, if you take off that part that you hold the jaws with, the mouth will not open because he get, you know, subhanAllah, the body cooled off on that state, so it will not open. All this is like, you know, is more experience than what happened in the sunnah, okay? So this is, there's no dalil athari. We don't have an evidence in this. But this is, the author, he's telling us, you know, how things are done in order to dignify and honor the deceased person. Also, to not have any of the insect or anything get inside the body. Especially in that environment in the desert, they have a lot of these things. قال وتليين مفاصله قال then he said وشد لحييه وتليين مفاصله. المفاصل are the joint, so he work out his joint to make them soft, his hands, like move his wrist, open up his hand and then put it back at the part of the elbow, and do the same for the legs. And this is the third thing to do. And this is an action that when the body cool off, it will not be difficult to wash the body. So this talyin, soften and move the joint, so to remain, you know, later easy to do the ghusl. And this is need to be done with softness, Because the body needs to be taken care of as if someone is alive. Not like, you know, treating a stone. This is a human being. It's a Muslim who died. And all this action need to be done with kindness and softness and care. Because there's people who like do this tajiz, this preparation for the dead person. It's like they're skinning out the person from his own skin. وَخَلْعِ ثِيَابِهِ to take off his clothes. The same thing need to be done with care and kindness and softness. And this is the fourth thing. And in this one also there is a dalil. When the Prophet ﷺ passed away, the companion قَالُ هَلْ نُجَرِّدُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَمَا نُجَرِّدُ مَوْتَانَ. Are we going to take off the clothes of the Prophet as we do for our dead ones? This hadith mentioned that everyone dead is they take off his clothes. But the Prophet, they didn't take off his clothes. They make ghusl over his clothes. Yujarridu is to take off. جَرَّدَهُ مِنْ ثِيَابِهِ He took off all his clothes. قَالَ وَسَتَرَهُ بِثَوْبٍ وَسَتَرَهُ بِثَوْبٍ This is the fifth thing. To cover him with the thawb, with the cloth. And this cloth need to cover the whole body. And the Prophet, when we when the Prophet ﷺ passed away, they covered him with a cover that covered his body. سُجِّيَ قَالَ بِبُرُدٍ حِبَرَةٍ And this is kind of cloth known at that time from Yemen. وَوَضْعُ حَدِيدَةٍ عَلَى بَطْنِهِ This is the sixth thing. They put a kind of a mass of iron or anything heavy on his stomach, on his belly. To avoid that the body will like swallow. But this is at that time. Now today people, if the time is going to get like, you know, for weight, they put them in the freezer and in the morgue. So this is, they have different ways how to do it. But this is the author is telling us how at that time when they didn't have these facilities and this means what they do. And do we have any dalil from the author? They mentioned that Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu said, he said about someone that he died, they said, put on his belly something heavy from iron, hadid. But wallahu a'lam fi hadh. But also putting something heavy doesn't avoid for the body to swallow if he's gonna take like long time. That's why from the honoring of the dead person is to hasten in preparing him to for the burial. Therefore, this is will not be required to do it because he's gonna be like a few hours and he's gonna be in the graveyard. Then قال ووضع حديدة على بطنه ووضعه على سرير غسله متوجها منحدرا نحو رجليه. And then to put on the bed of on which he's going to be to be washed. And the bed is not like the bed, it's like something like flat. Before they did it out of wood. قال متوجها متوجها mean facing the Qibla. منحدرا نحو رجليه little bit inclined toward his small inclination toward his legs. Then when he wash everything goes down to go and through the legs. So the inclination for a reason to not have the water, you know, remaining on the bed when they put it on, and to have everything, you know, that comes out from the body also to be easier with this inclination. قال وإسراع تجهيزه إن مات وإسراع تجهيزه. This is what we said. وإسراع تجهيزه إن مات غير فجأة غير فجأة. And to hasten in preparing him to bury him unless he died فجأة, unless the death comes a sudden death. They should not, at that time, they should not hasten to take him, to bury him. وَإِسْرَاعُ تَجْهِيزِ إِنْ مَاتَ غَيْرَ فَشْأَ. If it's a normal death, knowing someone, he was sick, and they saw his agony, and they make the talqeen, and then he died, that the one they need to hasten to do his burial. But someone's sudden death, he was standing and he faint. Because they can, if they hasten and the person didn't die, they're gonna cause, you know, end up by killing him. It becomes killing a soul. Because he faint, he's unconscious, he's not dead. وَإِسْرَاعُ تَجْهِيزِهِ. This is from the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال أسرعوا بالجنازة. أسرعوا, hasten with the janazah. The janazah, the burial that you taken, the funeral or the body. فإن تكو صالحة فخير تقدمونها إليه. If the person that you carrying is righteous, then it's good that you hasten to take him to his abode of goodness. وإن وَإِنْ تَكُ سِوَى ذَلِكَ. And if it's not like that, then it's something ill that you want to get rid of it, of your shoulder. So here, to hasten to take it to the graveyard to be buried, it will be also, by necessity, the fact also to hasten to prepare the body, so to be buried. إن مات غير إن مات here he said إن مات غير فجأة. إن مات غير فجأة. This is all if he died a normal death, not a sudden death. فإن مات فجأة فإنه لا يسن الإسراع بتجهيزه. He had the sudden death. It's not from the sunnah to hasten to prepare the body. Because it might be unconsciousness, it might be the person who lost conscience. Now today they have the material, and they have the material to check if this person is unconscious or not. Before they didn't. فَالْوَاجِبُ إِنْ مَاتَ فَشْأَةً أَنْ نَنْتَظِرَ بِهِ. The obligation is to wait. And this is what the scholar, they said, rahmatullahi alayhi. قال في الروض يعرف موته بانخساف صدغيه وميل أنفه وانفصال كفيه واسترخاء رجليه. There's four signs to know that the person died. انخسافي صدغيه. انخسافي الصدغ is this place here between the forehead is here, the place here. ينخسفو is like subhanallah, it swallow in, it go inside. It's like when someone open his jaws, it goes inside this part. Someone dies, it goes inside. Why? Because the jaws, they cannot control. So the jaws fall, the thing goes inside. In khasafa. Cave in. Say cave in. When the soul goes away, there is no control on anything. So, and then inclination of the nose, meili anfa. Because the nose will be straight when someone is alive. When he dies, it falls on one side, it inclines. وَانْفِصَالِ كَفَّيْهِ. The hands is like kind of, you know, not connected to the rest of the arm. They becomes like floppy, not connected anymore. The same for the feet. وَاسْتِرْخَاءِ رِجْلَيْهِ. So those are four signs. And a story has been narrated that a man, he fell unconscious. They thought he died. They took him to the maqbara. They carry him. And they walked in front of a person who has experience of death and dead people. فَقَالَ لَهُمْ مَا هَذَا. He told them, what this? قالوا هذه جنازة نريد أن ندفنها أن ندفنها. This is جنازة. We looking forward to bury it. قال هذا لم يمت أنزلوه. He said this one he didn't die. Put him down. فنزلوه فأتى بصوت. Came with the صوت. صوت, you know, the flag to slash a person. And he start to hit him till he start to move. فقالوا ما الذي حملك على هذا وما الذي علمك أنه لميت. He said, why did you do this and what make you think that this person didn't die. قال إن الميت تسترخي رجلاه فلا تنتصبا. The dead person, his feet becomes floppy, falling. They were not standing like this. He said, when you were carrying this person and his legs were uncovered, they were standing. منتصبان. He didn't die. وهذا الذي حملتم, and the one that you were carrying, رجلاه منتصبتان. They were standing. Still life. There's life inside these legs, these feet. وأما ضربي إياه بالصوت. But me hitting him with the صوت. فلأن الضرب يحمي الجسم, because heating warm the body, and when he get warmed up, he moved, so he's not dead. قال وحمي جسمه زالت عنه البرودة التي هي سبب الغشي. And to warm back his body, removed that unconsciousness which was caused by certain coldness. You know, he felt like, subhanallah. ثم حملوه راجعين به إلى بيته. They took him back to his house. If it wasn't Allah's will for this person to see him, they would have killed him. So people here, they don't say mistake. The fuqaha, they say they killed him. Why? Because he died, you know, a sudden death, or he fell, it doesn't mean he died, so you have to wait. But bring people of expertise, people who know to check if this person died or not. Yeah. If he died in the morning, after Asr, he need to be in the graveyard. If he died at Maghrib time, so he will be in the next day, because it's always good to bury at light time, which is after Asr usually. So should not get, you know, should be less than 24 hours. And if there's condition with someone, you know, they need to, you know, like in today's condition, you know, to be released from the hospital, things like that. But usually it's like thing to be done very fast. And that's honoring the dead person. Huh? No, the normal death. Sudden death, we have to wait. Because sudden death, there is no proof that he died. Unless there's expert, but at that time they didn't know, like this one. Imagine someone open his eyes and he's in the grave. The people who bury, they are strong people, so they be sure that he will not come out. He's dead.
قال فإسراع التجهيز بشرط أن يموت غير فجأة.
So to hasten the preparation of the body with the condition that he didn't die a sudden death.
فإن مات فجأة وجب الانتظار.
If he died sudden death, we need to wait. But not to wait because he has some certain relative, they need to come and everything, that's not right. طيب. There's a question which is been the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he died on Monday and only was buried on Wednesday. The reason that the Imam, when he died, he should not be buried till he will have the successor being appointed. So he said, we will not bury our Imam till someone will succeed him. This is what will be, you know, to have like everyone will be mobilized to have the Imam. Because without the Imam, the Ummah will be like get into conflict and chaos of dispute and differences. So said, we don't bury our Imam till we'll have a successor.
قال وإنفاذ وصيته وإنفاذ وصيته,
and to fulfill his will, to fulfill his will, his last will. After burying him, the first thing is to fulfill his will, what he has, you know, in his last will to be fulfilled. But here there's, you know, more details. For to hasten in fulfilling his will, part of it is an obligation and part of it is recommended. Because if part of the will is obligation to be done, then it's an obligation to do it very fast.
part of his will to be paid for him all the burial. So they need to do it right then. If not, they cannot bury. Part of the will is to pay, you know, the whatever he has as debt, because the debts will be like he will be on hold because of those debts, so they wasn't paid. In a hadith, قال نفس المؤمن معلقة بدينه حتى يقضى عنه. The soul of a believer is kind of held on the debt till it will be fulfilled and paid. That's why he came after that. قال ويجب في قضاء دينه. So the will and part of the will that it need to be done before everything is قضاء الدين, because the debt need to be reduced from the estate. So the estate, you know, like all the kids and the family, they get the money and they said, now we're going to pay the debt. No, the debt need to be paid off, because the soul of their father or their parents or their mother or whoever who died is subhanAllah, is in hold of that, so of that debt. And here, قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نفس المؤمن معلقة بديني حتى يقضى عنه. And in another hadith, with this hadith weak, but there's an hadith who strengthen this action, which is قال عن أبي قدادة في الرجل الذي جيء به إلى الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم فسأل هل عليه دين. A man came, brought the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to offer salatul janaza on him. He said, does he has a debt? قالوا نعم ديناران. He has two dinar as a debt. فتأخر ولم يصلي عليه. The Prophet, he moved back to not pray on him. فقال أبو قتادة الديناران علي يا رسول الله. أبو قتادة, he said, I will take care of his debt. قال حق الغريم وبريء منهما الميت. It became the right of the one who had the debt on you, ya Aba Qatada. And the dead one, he is now bari. Bari is like fully not accountable on it. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But there is a hadith actually. This is happened when in the time of the Muslim they were kind of in a hard situation. But when Islam and the society start to get like, you know, kind of enough wealth, and you know, the Prophet ﷺ used to pay their debts, those who had debts. So he'll pray on them. You know, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Auna awla bihim."
What if it's a long-term debt, and the person that
died,
you know, they didn't have to be paid in full, or if somebody else took over their debt?
No, they paid it. They paid it on the according to the terms. Because everything is according to the term. Not the exigency of paying the debt comes with the death of the person, but follow the term of the debt, of the contract, the initial contract. Tayyib, we'll stop here, inshallah, in this first part, and next time we'll start the second part of Kitabul Janaz, Al-Faslu Thani, inshallah. كتاب الجنائز, we have, I think, four parts. Actually, six, I think. After كتاب الجنائز, we start كتاب الزكاة, إن شاء الله. Any question? Yes.
A question. In the case of concerns for foul play in the death of the person, you know, when you said you have to ask in the burial, sometimes you need some investigation of what happened, somebody feels like something happened on the side. What is the problem with that?
About the kind.
The death was not, was this for foul play? You know, maybe someone was poisoned or
like autopsy or things?
Yeah.
It depends on the maslaha, if it has, you know, it depends on the awliya, on the family, if they allow that for the sake to know who is the because of this investigation, to look for the, if anyone, ill person, he did such a thing, that will be permissible. And if the family, they say no, and they want to hasten the janazah, it goes back to them. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala قَالَ وَمَنْ قُتِلَ مَظْلُومًا فَقَدْ جَعَلْنَا لِوَلِيِّ سُلْطَانًا. The one who died, مَظْلُومًا, transgressed, so the wali, his wali, his own family, those who have the judgment, the power to deal with the one who hurt him or who killed him. So in that case, they will wait. It depends on the investigation. So it depends on the decision of the family. Yes.
So nowadays, unlike other times of the Prophet, there are people are put in a tree when they die, so they can stay in home. What is that okay?
Yes, yeah. Before they did all this, because they didn't have this means. For example, they put the heavy thing on the belly, and they tie the jaws, all of that for this condition. So if they have, you know, means like today, then as we said, that's it happened by the habit, the way how it's being done. So, you know, the same thing, like for example, the people how they used to eat and what use as utensils. Now there's a new thing that someone use. It's not gonna say if there's a proof in it. This is one of the improvement of the conditions, you know, around us on these things. You know, we have paper now. Before they have, you know, leaves that they write in it. So this is the way of the condition, how it changed, so it doesn't change, of course. I mean, as long as it fulfilled the objective, which is to maintain the body and to honor it. Yeah. Any other question? Yes.
We have a lot of young people who want to, when they get in the driver's license, they say, okay, we can donate our body
to whatever. No, no. To be written as someone a donor, right? Yeah, that's not accepted. We need to specify the body is a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Afterward, if the family, there's someone in need, that's the one that the family decide to give. But to put random, that whenever someone he die, they empty all his body before, you know, to give his body to be buried, that's a transgression and dishonor of the one who passed away. Because they're gonna put all his parts in a bank, frozen for someone to come have money to buy it maybe. And that's all. We don't want to get into the detail what they do with it, but in the detail of honoring of the body. Everything is a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, if there's this one who dying, and there's someone who's really in need of a heart or in need of anything, so that is really you're going to give a life. That is becomes a sadaqah. Sadaqah, amen, you know where it's going. Not like in the air, pour it in the store and put on it a database. That's not right. And those who have these things and he died in hospital, they take everything. So be buried without eyes, without all. I mean, this is. Any other question? So Islam doesn't forbid such action. But he put it in a balanced and honored way. It's not like, you know, someone to be himself, like put a donor, then to steal everything from him. Because when he's dying, they're not asking. They don't. And they will not ask the family. And it caused a lot of hurt. Even, I mean, we're talking about everybody. I mean, there's a story when, you know, people, like a person, non-Muslim, of course, she saw her mother, you know, when being given the body, it was like something like unbearable to see. They took everything. So if there is a life out there suffering, yes, when someone died. But someone is still alive and he put himself in a database that they can take everything, no, that's not acceptable.
It's not a question about when you see people who, when they die here, then they, the body is transported back to their country of origin.
Yeah. Like the ruling is, wherever someone dies, he should bury it in the place where he died. Unless transporting of the body, it has, you know, meaning for the whole family, or there's a maslaha in it. So the scholar, that depends on the situation. If there's maslaha in it, then they can do it, and then also, they go through a procedure which is, you know, difficult procedure to empty the whole body from all the liquid, and so they can transport themselves. So it needs to be analyzed and examined by case.